Welcome to episode 113 of the Guardian One podcast. We record live Thursdays at 8 p.m. Pacific, 11 Eastern, right here on twitch.tv/Guardian One Network. My name is Remy, and tonight I am joined by Jez.
Good morning.
Agrios.
Greetings, Guardians.
Sharks.
Merry Christmas! Happy Hanukkah! Happy Dawning! Okay.
And Gray.
Good evening, everybody.
We're going to be talking about all things Destiny, but first, housekeeping.
Hello, Guardians. Thank you for listening in on the podcast, however it is that you are choosing to listen. Be sure to follow Guardian One on Twitter at G1Net. That's G, the number one, N-E-T. In addition, be sure to check out the Guardian One website at guardianone.net. If you want to send us an email, you can send it to feedback@guardianone.net. If you do a search on budget.net for Guardian One, you'll find our forums group, which we also use for both comments and feedback. Big thank you to all those currently in the Twitch chat. As Remy said at the top of the podcast, you can watch the show live at twitch.tv/Guardian One Network. We broadcast every Thursday at 11 p.m. Eastern, 8 p.m. Pacific. If you can't catch the show live, you can always search for the Guardian One podcast on iTunes, as well as the Guardian One YouTube channel at youtube.com/Guardian One Network. Guardian One is a proud member of the Guardian Radio Network, so be sure to check out the Guardian Radio Network website at theguardiansofdestiny.com. There you'll find all the different podcasts as part of the network, including the flagship podcast, Guardian Radio. They broadcast every Monday night at 8:30 p.m. Eastern, 5:30 p.m. Pacific on twitch.tv/Guardian Radio. You can also follow their Twitter account at Guardians of D and their YouTube channel, youtube.com/Guardians of D. Other podcasts that are part of the Guardian Radio Network include previous episodes of TTL Party Chat and Robust Radio. There's also a podcast called Ghost and Echoes, which contains a fan fiction YouTube channel, audio versions of .com/cards found within Destiny. That's it for housekeeping. I'll see you again soon.
Alrighty, that lineup does also now include Focus Fire Chat, which is really excellent stuff. A very special welcome to Connor, a friend of Gray's. I had a chance to play a couple Nightfalls with him. Very cool person. His gamer tag is Connie the Commie. I should ask him what that's all about, because that's a very interesting name. But if you see him on the Xbox side one, give him a what's up. Welcome to the group, buddy. Tomorrow is my youngest son's birthday. He will be 2 years old tomorrow. And I want to thank him. I want to give him a very special thank you, because 2 years ago and a couple of weeks ago, the Dark Below dropped, and we were thinking, you know, he's going to show up right as this expansion comes out. And while I'm happy to do family life things over Destiny, it was really great to get to play that new content and not have to worry about that. So thank you, Richard. It was very nice of you to show up when you did. Also, next Tuesday, the 27th, Guardian One turns 3 years old. It will be 3 years since I officially started the clan, and it's very, very exciting times. I want to do something special. I want to do some kind of clan get together. So if you're part of the Guardian One group, or if you're a friend of Guardian One group and you want to take part in this, I don't know what it'll be. I think that some kind of Sparrow Racing would be really cool, or maybe some custom games would be really excellent. But I don't know. I want to do something special on that day, because 3 years, it's been 3 years. It's quite a while. Happy birthday, Guardian One. I wanted to say, okay. Welcome back, Agrios. We did not have Agrios last week, and I wanted to do a little catch up with him. He went to go see Rogue One. Really quickly, no spoilers, was Rogue One cool, worth seeing, Agrios?
It was definitely very cool. It's definitely worth seeing. Depending on the young one, it may not be for all young ones. It's definitely more the kind of more grittiest, kind of more real kind of perspective on what's going on, as far as like the average person, maybe, so to speak, at this point in time. I heard a quote before I went to see it, and this gave me high hopes for it, and I think it was a good quote for it was, but this was the first Star Wars movie to really acknowledge that this is about war.
Interesting. I don't know exactly what that means, but I'm looking forward to seeing it. J.J. Abrams didn't have anything to do with this one, yeah?
No, I don't think so.
No.
I think he consulted on it because of Star Wars universe and stuff right now. I believe I saw something about him visiting the set and whatnot, but I don't think he had any official part in it, no.
Good. Good, I hate that guy.
I don't know anything he's done so far, really.
Okay, so last week we talked about a couple of things, and I wanted to get your opinion on them. Iron Banner, did you get anything cool out of it? Did you enjoy it? What was your take on this last Iron Banner?
Me?
Yeah.
I got a bunch of cool scout rifles. I have four or five different rules on that scout rifle that are all fairly different right now. Feel very different in their usage. So I was kind of having fun with those. They were decent rewards. I had a lot going on last week. I only had time to get one of my characters up to rank 5. But I went into so I could buy the Vendor Scout because I like the role on that. But that's the only character that I got my things done on. I didn't get any of my Iron Banner done on my second two characters. I just had a lot going on last week. It was my birthday last week, as well as I went to the Rogue One premiere and such. So I was busy for quite a bit last week.
Happy belated birthday. The Bungie posted some information about a new Crucible connection, the way they're going to do that. Did you notice any difference? They said that they were loosening up the requirements as far as skill was concerned. Like they wanted to put an even higher emphasis on connection. Did you notice anything different?
I can tell you, I did not notice an improvement in the connection of the people I was playing.
So you still had Red Bar Warriors?
Yeah, tons of them. First match I went into, I had two lowest of the low Red Bar Warriors up against me. And that was fairly prevalent throughout my entire experience. I don't really know that I felt a lot of change in the skill department as far as doing better or worse relative to other people in the matches that I was playing. But I definitely don't feel like my connection was better, for sure.
Interesting. The Dawning. We haven't had a chance to catch up with you about The Dawning. Last week I asked everyone to come up with one word to describe The Dawning and then give it how many stars out of 5, and then please go into what it is that extrapolate on your one word answer.
Plentiful.
I like it.
I feel like, as opposed to the Halloween event, they didn't diminish the amount of things there were to do last year. Now, grain of salt here. This isn't just the Sparrow Racing event, though. This is an update to continue on in Destiny. We're going to continue the Dawning after the Sparrow Racing event ends. We're going to continue to get Dawning packages on a weekly basis. So this was really the introduction of two things at once. So it depends on how you want to dissect that look at it. If I'm going to look at just the content drop, that's how my Plentiful provides. I have the new weekly bounties from Zavala. I have the new strike scoring. I have the new elite bounties from the regular bounty guy. I've got, new armor sets, new exotics to chase. Lots of stuff to do. But a lot of that is going to stay around after SRL. If you really want to, you know, cut all of that out of the picture, they really didn't change much of SRL from last year. We basically got two more tracks, and that's the only thing different they've done this year. I mean, we had the packages with the Sparrows in them last year. We have the packages with the Sparrows in them this year. It really is pretty much a facsimile of last year if you cut out all the Dawning stuff that's sticking around. So my playful one really applies to the whole thing. But they didn't unimprove it. They didn't go downhill with the SRL event, and that's the most important thing. I really feel like the Halloween event, they went downhill from last year, and that's not a good way to go.
I agree. Gray's descriptive word was petite. Shark's descriptive word was finally. Jez, what was your descriptive word?
I hope you weren't cutting to me because my headset decided to stop hearing things at the time that you were talking.
Yeah, I was asking you what your descriptive word for the Dawning was last
time. Oh, I thought you, I heard, oh, his descriptive word is this, and Jess's descriptive word was, and then my headset's like waking out. I'm like, no. I'll see what he's talking about when he gets back. And then it's just nothing. It was whelming.
Whelming, that's what it was. That's why I couldn't remember it, because it was
a non-word.
A word I don't hear very often. And my word was excellent, because I feel like what they've brought to us in this update is excellent. And, you know, at first it was difficult for me to separate what is going to stay around and what's not. And I just realized just yesterday, the day before, that the other packages from Zavala's Elite Bounties are excellent pieces of gear. Like they're reused, but they were blue sets. They were blue sets, and now they're legendary. And those are going to be sticking around, right? If Zavala's Elite Bounties are sticking around,
they have to.
Man, that's fantastic news. I'm so excited about that because this is the first time when these bounties came out. I've run 8 Nightfalls since those bounties came out, and I don't know when the last time I ran a Nightfall was before that. So I wasn't really paying attention to those other ones, because what I wanted was the Icebreaker. And it's really cool to hear that those other pieces of armor are going to be sticking around, because I love that Titan set. I played my Titan for the first time in the longest time.
I actually want to change my word. I want to go back on my word.
Okay.
Part of my reasoning to go back on it was that some of the quests I hadn't unlocked yet. And it wasn't until this week that I had ranked up certain aspects to unlock more content, essentially. I didn't even know about the content. This whole, what is it, Nova Mortis quest? Didn't even know it existed last week. So I'm going to change my word from petite to appropriate. I think that if this was a quarterly live event, right, if we had live events that were quarterly, this would be an appropriate amount of content for a quarterly live event.
I really like that.
And an event.
Right, and I want both. I want both. And you know what? I feel like there's this natural flow to the group of people who play this game. Like when this latest raid came out, I saw this huge uptick in players in the entire community, and those people stuck around for probably a month, 6 weeks, maybe 8 weeks, like maybe a nice 2 month chunk. I would really like to see a capitalization on the first month, at least, when something comes out. I want there to be this transformation in the world. Instead of everything just changing and here's this and this is just the way it is, I want it to be something that rolls out over 4 weeks. I would really love to see, you know, because everybody is playing at this point, and it was really exciting to always have friends on and always know that, you know, oh, this group of people is doing this. Let's get organized and let's do this. And I really loved the feel of that, and I want to see Bungie capitalize on that, but in a way that that unfolds, it would reward you for being there during that period, other than just always having someone online to play with. Because while that is rewarding, having a bunch of people who are playing because of the content, I want there to be a reason to be there at that time. Like, I expect that content to continue, or at least a good majority of that content to continue, because right now there is no difference between playing that content then and playing that content now. The only difference is the amount of players that are in the, that are ready to play. That's it. That's the only thing that I can see. There is no, there isn't, you know, oh, you know, the first week of this expansion, you know, you get a cool emblem or something, like, or there's a special quest, or I don't know what it would be. But I want there to be an ongoing reason in the beginning for people to want to come back and do these things. And I don't know. I want to talk more about that. Maybe we should have that for a subject next week. Everybody listening, if you have an idea of what you think would be appropriate or cool for that kind of thing, I would love to hear it, and I would love to add it. So everybody on this panel, also think about what it would be, what it could be for, like, let's say 4 weeks. You know, a quarterly update. The first 4 weeks are where this expands and you live in this world, you know, where you make these connections and it unfolds slowly. Not just here is a regular mode and then next week is hard mode, you know, like that's cool. And I'm glad that there's a stagger there, but I want there to be this adventure. I want there to be this road traveled. I want there to be a reason to be there in the beginning, you know. I want there to be something for us to digest and discuss, and, you know, maybe a mystery, or maybe, you know, like a story, the unfolding of a story. Like, it would be really fantastic. Here is this initial drop, boom, you get these done, and then that's it for now. You know, you can go play other games or whatever. Next week, here's this another set of rollout of stuff. So if you're interested, send me this information, feedback@guardian1.net. And we will see you next week.
Here's your instant feedback. The normal mode of a raid should, instead of unlocking hard mode a couple weeks later, the final boss should drop an item that you turn in. And then it's so many items turned in from the entire community, and it unlocks the next step to the quest.
I love that. I love that idea. That's a great idea. This goes right along with almost like that owl sector, you know, like here is this. I don't know, they're calling it a disease or whatever, but it was passing to people. And I feel like, you know, once you hit a certain volume, that unlocks something. This is a really great idea, Jez. I like that a lot. I love the idea of the community pushing towards a goal. And by now, they have to have metrics on what people do naturally, not just with an additional carrot like that. That's a really great idea. Agrios, did you have anything to throw at me right now? It's okay. You can just come back to me next week.
Muted. You're muted. Huh? He's muted.
I thought he was just you know, really pondering it. I was expecting the beard stroke, you know. Did you have anything to throw into this right now, Agrios?
No, that's a great idea on Jez's part. I mean, I really don't like how they handle the raid stuff right now. I don't like how they handle it so close to, like, the drop date of the, like, new material, and I would prefer they just stretch all that out. I felt like in the beginning of the game, it had good pacing.
Interesting. Sharks, did you have anything to throw into this right now?
If we're going to talk about it next week, I'll give points.
Good. Put some thought into it.
I just have to ask, Agrios, you said you thought the beginning of the game was a good pacing. Problem with it is, sure, you did get the full week first, but it was normal mode, hard mode. It was right unlocked from the get-go.
Oh, they were both unlocked from the get-go?
Are you sure? Are you sure? I don't think so.
Yeah. I'm sure as soon as you finish normal mode, you can queue up for hard mode.
Interesting. I don't remember it being like that, but maybe maybe you're right.
What are you guys talking about? Rise of Iron?
No, we're talking about Vault of Glass.
Vault of Glass.
Oh,
glass, I have no glass hard isn't open.
Great.
I think so.
Oh.
Gray, did you have anything you wanted to throw into this?
I would say that for whatever the duration is between live events, they need to have missions like the Black Spindle mission, secret quests that fill in those gaps, that time. And I don't think that they should all be available day one when that update releases. I think it should be every 3 weeks this secret mission unlocks and so you can figure it out. And maybe even have it advertised. Every 3 weeks there's going to be a secret mission so you can figure out where it's located in the game. And then you've got this race and you engage the player base to go and figure this out. And then dangle a pretty good carrot out there to get people to do it. I mean, Black Spindle was a great carrot to really work hard after. Imagine if they did three or four of those between every one of these content gaps. It's a secret mission you got to figure out and you get something really cool for it. I think that's what they got to do.
I like that too. Paste secret stuff. Okay. Yeah. We'll talk about it next week. I will write down some ideas. You guys write down some ideas and we'll go at it from there. I would like to ask you all, does anyone here have Icebreaker yet? No one. Okay, so I started to complain about this in the Guardian 1 chat, and Sharks told me not to be that guy. Sharks told me not to be that guy. And I don't want to be that guy, but I've done 8 Nightfalls, and it has not dropped for me. And now I understand that this is probably, you know, like there's still some waiting to be done. But as somebody who didn't get Mythoclast until just a couple months ago, and also someone who I've never got Fatebringer, not once, I've never had any of Crota ships drop in easy mode or hard mode. Like there's some stuff that I've done so many times, and I've still never got it. And so I start to get a little antsy. I start to get a little crazy because, you know, some of this stuff is just never going to drop for me. You know, I don't know how many more times I would have to defeat Crota in order to get any of those ships because none of them have ever dropped for me. And I talked to one person and he says that a ship drops for him every single time he runs through one of those drop. It was one of Connor's friends, Larry. He said every time he goes through, he gets a ship. I've never received a ship. I've never got a Fatebringer. The only reason I got Mythoclast is because of Maynard James. Thank you, Maynard James. I've used it just a couple of times. It's nice to have it. It's nice not to have it hanging over my head. But Icebreaker is something that I would definitely use, and I would definitely love to have. But yeah,
You know how many times Sharks and I ran the Dark Below? I mean, every single week, him and I would get all three of our characters through on hard mode, like over and over and over and over again. I never got the hard mode Crota ship.
Oh, yeah?
Character.
Sharks?
I didn't get the Sparrow.
What Sparrow?
The Sparrow in Dark Below.
There's a Sparrow in Dark Below? Huh?
That's crazy.
Yep.
I didn't even know that there was one.
Yep, there's a Sparrow. And also, okay, so you know how they fixed New Monarchy's ship wasn't dropping, right? Mm-hmm. And I don't remember how many weeks back, but it's quite a few weeks back that they fixed that bug. And the bug had to do with if you had a dead orbit ship, which I did, then it wasn't dropping for those people. And I was like, okay, whatever. I know they'll eventually fix it. And the instant they fixed it, with the mount that I play, I mean, you guys all know I play an awful lot. I was buying all the materials, using all my marks on materials. I was flipping the characters. I was using motes. I made sure I had my my new monarchy bond on. I flipped that character an extra, 50 times in between the update. And just yesterday, when I received that ship finally.
Oh, man.
So, okay, now, the thing is like, it's frustrating, and I can see what you're saying about not getting Icebreaker, but one thing you have to say is that you said you've done it 8 times, right?
Yes.
Okay, that's off of an Xbox and a PlayStation.
Correct.
So, in reality, you've done it, let's say, 6 times on PlayStation.
Okay.
That drop rate isn't really that low yet, because it's each character has a percentage of getting it, right? And basically you're saying that you should have had the Icebreaker drop within 2 bounties.
Well, I would have accepted in any of those 8 bounties, really. Like,
I know, but what I'm saying
that's why
in reality you've only done it for 2 weeks. That's not really very long.
That's why I wanted to run those Nightfalls today.
Can't discount the Xbox drop rates just because it's a different console. It's still a chance at it, and the chance is always the same.
Right, the percentage is the same. So that's what I'm saying. So what Remy's saying, though, is that within a 7-day period, because that would be the quickest you could possibly do this, he expected to have Icebreaker.
Well, I mean, I see it all over the community.
Count those consoles, because you may have a cumulative percentage toward getting it. Like, every bounty that you want, one of those bounties you complete and don't get it, may increase your odds slightly of getting it on the next bounty. So if it's cumulative like that, and that's how, like, they've done some other things in this game, supposedly.
It took me 4 weeks, and that's running 3 characters. So 12 times to get Thorn Bounty. Okay, it's a big deal. You've only had it 7 days.
You know,
I wouldn't want it to drop yet, because for one, I'm not tired of it. But for two, is my favorite moment right now in the game is right before I click that bounty to cash it in, right? Because you don't know what's going to happen. You have something to look forward to. Once I have it, that's going to get bounty, boring.
If you're done with the bounty, you're going to be like, okay, back to I'm bored with Destiny. I'm going to go and find another game to play. Like most of the community is out there. So
totally. You know, totally.
What?
So
I'm
what?
Glad it's not dropping for people. I think it's awesome.
But that's just it, Sharks, it is dropping for people. It's dropping for people all over the community. Like,
there are millions of people playing. That's not okay. So Destin Laguerre. I don't know if you heard this on Fireteam chat a couple weeks before, maybe it was the week before before this dropped. He goes, okay, so Icebreaker's going to drop. I guess I'm going to have a reason to go in and do it one nightfall, get my Icebreaker, and then I can go back to doing something else. So Bungie's not stupid. They're sitting there saying, okay, if people are going to stop playing and they're going to stop doing the Nightfall after Icebreaker drops, we're not going to have it drop on a high percentage for everybody.
But here's the thing, Sharks, as I've already reached this point in Destiny where, because I don't know what the future holds, I don't want to delete all my stuff. I don't want to go out and hoard a bunch more stuff. But I'm at the point where I am that rat who's pressing the button for a treat, and I'm not getting the treat that I want. And so I'm beginning to feel like, you know what? Screw it. Do I even really need Icebreaker? So now I'm starting to look at the times that I've gone through this Nightfall, which isn't a big deal. And actually, I'm having a lot of fun playing with my friends. But I feel like I just want that fucking Icebreaker. That's all. It's like I wouldn't stop playing necessarily, but I'm not getting what I want out of this, you know?
That's the problem, Remy. Icebreaker needs to be the bonus. Playing with your friends on the Nightfall needs to be why you're doing it.
You know what, though? What I am liking about this is that you're basically double-dipping on a Nightfall, because you get whatever drop you get from that character at the end of the Nightfall, and then you turn in that bounty, and you get, you know, what I have found to be even better stuff. Like, from the Nightfalls, I'm 398. I will get like a 399 piece of gear, but when I turn in Zavala's bounty, I just straight up get something 400. Like, so I don't know.
But yeah, I just say those other two bounties are awesome because I can solo those.
That is cool. And the gear they drop is awesome.
Something to be said too is you said about a lot of people getting them already that you see it out there. If something, say it has a 10% drop rate, that means you need to turn in 10 of those bounties before you get it, which you haven't done yet, so you haven't completed even that to get it.
Well, that's also gambler's fallacy.
That means 100 and a million, say a million people are playing Destiny, 100,000 of them are going to get it first bounty they turn in.
I know, and that pisses me off.
that's somebody... why you see so many out there. Even if it's something small, like you have to turn in 10 bounties to even come close to hitting the odds of getting it, you know?
What were you saying, Jez, about the gambler's fallacy?
I said that's gambler's fallacy to assume that after, like, if it's a 10% chance to drop and you do 10 bounties, you're guaranteed to get it. That's gambler's fallacy.
It's not true.
No, I didn't say you're guaranteed to get it. I did.
It's still 10 chances of 10%.
You're likely to get it by the time you've done 10. Your odds are better of having got it than not by the time you do 10.
Additionally, I have to get it on both systems. So even if I got it on one system, I'd still have to do it on the other system.
I did do it in Nightfall and got my first 400.
I'm going to throw something else into this equation. Okay, so obviously, we're going to go back to that I've played lots. I have collected almost everything at one point or another. There was a point in the game that I was missing one item, one gun. Hawkmoon. And I got it the day of the expansion. Okay, so...
When it was also on Xbox as well?
Yes. Okay. Now the thing is like you can look at it and say, okay, well that sucks. You know, you didn't get it. You didn't get to use it in its heyday. You know, there's all kinds of negative aspects of it, but you can also look at it as a positive. Like I had everything. There was no reason for me to play Destiny at all in reality, but I played every single week. So I could get that. I went and did all, you know, we even did that was back in the day when we were doing the chess cheese on Vault of Glass. Remember, nobody was playing Vault of Glass anymore, but we were going in middle of the night between the three of us, saving that spot so that we had it the next week and going to open those chests to get that loot, right?
That was fun.
Now the thing is like, because there was something, there was that carrot dangling, and it was never in my reach. I could never get it, but it was there, and so it made it entertaining, okay? Would I have loved to have gotten Hawkmoon in its heyday? Yes, for sure. But at the same time, because I didn't, I have all that extra, you know, all that stuff that I did trying to chase it, and how excited I was when it dropped that day. I was yelling and screaming. You know, it was awesome. And I'm pretty sure Agrius was in the tower at that point too. He's like, "What's going on?" I was like, "I got Hawkmoon! I finally got it!" And he's like, "You know, it sucks now." And I go, "I don't care, I got it!" You know, so maybe that's going to be you with Icebreaker the day before Destiny 2 releases.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know that I'll be around waiting for it that long. You know, like I'm pressing this button and I'm waiting for my treat and I'm not getting it.
Yeah, and you know, I can confirm that. While yeah, you want that carrot dangling, but the longer that carrot's there, the more you're just gonna burn out on trying, and you're just gonna give up.
Right? No, that's where I am.
And I'm not. In reality, I don't wish upon Remy that he waits until the day before Destiny 2 to get it. I hope that he gets it very soon. But I think the expectation of getting it within 7 days of its release is ridiculous. Personally,
maybe.
Yeah, and like I'll preface my statements too that I said I'm not to the point yet where that experience of cashing in that bounty is just, oh, here we go again, another time I'm not going to get Icebreaker. Like, it's still exciting every time I cash it in. I'll reach that point just like you, Remy. I'll reach a certain point that I'm like, this is just bullshit at this point. I don't even care about this stupid bounty. It's been so long that I haven't gotten what I want. I'm just not quite there. If you're already there, that's a little bit of a rough place to be in, because it's, you know, it could be a while until most of the people in the Destiny community have Icebreaker. For the people that do have it, though, Remy, and you've probably interacted with them more than I have, is year three Icebreaker good? Is it a good gun?
Yeah. Yeah, they updated it, and it's super sweet. That's all I keep hearing. That's all I keep hearing about how sweet it is, and Snapshot is the best, and I don't know. I played around with it a lot in when it was when 160 was still a reasonable power level. And I missed it. I miss it right now because it was really a go-to. Like, it was really something that I just used it as my exotic, because it just fits so many situations that were important to me.
For PvP and PvE, or just one or the other?
No, I would never use it in PvP.
A lot of people did, though.
A lot of people did, and I heard that it's still a one-shot kill. So
it is. Even the old one is.
Oh, right now it is?
Yeah, Maynard James was... We were in a group during the last Iron Banner, and, you know, all the hype was about this Icebreaker. And he's like, you know what? I'm going to try something. I was like, what are you going to try? And he goes, I got to get my Icebreaker. I go, what are you doing? I go, you're going to leave it on. You're going to forget and not be, you know, 399 or 400 or wherever he was, and you're going to get crap loot. And he did. He forgot too, but he loved it because it one shot headshot killed.
In the game, for the most part, they do like double the damage needed to kill you if it's a headshot. So as long as it's a headshot, you're dead.
That's true.
Doesn't matter what.
I would only use it in PvP gray or PvE gray because it's really rowdy. Like the stability is really low, which is why
trade off is for
right.
The reason.
Right, but yeah, but something, you know, something like Valis to Ark, you know, that just, you just need to outweigh him as far as damage versus time goes. You know, you take less damage than you're giving out to him, and then you're good to go. And you know what? And I want to mention too that I know that I sound like a crying baby when I'm complaining about this, and I'm just being honest. I'm just being honest. Like, I just really want this stupid thing.
I don't think you're a crying baby, and I'm just trying to make the other point to the whole thing, you know. And I just think it's a little early yet to be upset. But I personally am kind of worried, and the reason I'm worried is it was such a go-to gun back in the day. I don't want to have that go-to gun now. I was glad that they, you know, they kind of moved on from that. And, you know, I remember when I got my Icebreaker for the first time, I was underneath the deck with K-Dub and his son. And we were doing a nightfall. It was like the first or second week or whatever it was. I don't know. It was pretty early on. And I got this gun and I was like, oh, I got some exotic. And he's like, oh, that's an awesome gun. I was like, is it? I don't know anything about it. And like after that, like that's all I used. I used that so much for so long. And it, you know, it kind of, it lost it for me. You know, getting that gun again, I don't want to have one on every character, because that's what I did. I literally, I had one on each character and I had one Gjallarhorn on each character for the entire first year and a half of Destiny, you know. It's like, I don't know, you know, and I think
they solved that a little bit, those sharks, and here's why. There weren't that many great exotics in year one. Start by saying that. There wasn't that big of a gulf between the good legendaries and the average exotics. Not that much different. Unless the exotic was really special, it wasn't worth running. There were elemental primary legendaries, and there were a lot of really good legendaries when the game came out. Really,
that's true.
Like, a lot of legendaries that were better than a lot of the exotics.
Yeah.
And I think you could get away with using your exotic for the Icebreaker a lot easier in that early game because you had so many other good weapons and elemental primaries and things to fill that slot. Whereas now, I think maybe they've done a good job of making other exotics that are indispensable, Outbreak Prime for Fallen damage, or
Zalo
for Arc damage, or Black Spindle for not being able to have to wait for a reload if necessary.
No, you're totally right. And in reality, you don't even have to use exotics. I mean, 90% of the time, I don't have an exotic equipped.
And also,
I
thought you were going to finish what you're saying.
Yeah, the only time I have an exotic equipped is during trials. I have my golden truth. And during Arc Burn, I have Zallow. But I mean, the rest of the time, I love using legendaries. And maybe I'm at a little bit of a disadvantage, but overall, nowadays, most of those legendaries do the job more than adequate. And the other thing that I agree with you that maybe they have fixed a lot of this. Back in the day when we all started playing, and unfortunately Gray won't have felt this as much, but even he will have seen this, is that there was a lot of camping in hiding spots for hard game modes, whether it was raids, nightfalls, etc. It's not really like that anymore. The game has progressed, which is awesome, I think, personally. That we go in there and it's like, it's full bore, go in there and just kick butt. I mean, you can get those spots and maybe use guns like that to help you out. But, like if you want to solo a nightfall, but even now, especially with some of the quests that they have, you got to get it done in such and such a time or you're not going to get your super loot, that you're after. So you kind of got to go in there full bore. And so the game has changed, it's evolved. So maybe it won't matter. But those are just some of the thoughts that have gone through my mind.
So Sharks, this might be a public service announcement, and I just want to get your guys' feel on this, because it seemed like Nightfall was extremely achievable this week. Like, probably the easiest Nightfall I have ever done was Sepix Prime. Do you guys think that was the same or not?
Okay, so I want to share this. So I wanted to get as many of the Nightfalls done this week as possible so that when I came on the show, I could be like, I ran 12 Nightfalls and I didn't get it. So what ended up happening is I ended up getting to run two more from this week on the Xbox, and I ran them with Manny. Or no, wait, Connor was this week. Manny was last week. That's right. Okay, I'll share this anyway since I'm already talking about it. It was me and Manny and my son, my 8-year-old. And the first time we ran through it, it was really easy. We were both Titans. We both had bubbles. It was a lot of fun, and it was easy. And then we end up running our he ran a Hunter, I think, and I ran a Warlock, and it came down to the last 35 seconds of the Nightfall in order to get that bounty. And that was like, I don't know, that was crazy. But shout out Lawnboy, because that was a lot of fun. Awesome. this week's was a lot of fun. I ran one with Connor and my son. And then I ran one with Connor and his friend Larry, and it's really easy. It's really fun. There are parts that are, a little bit harrowing. Like there are a lot of enemies, especially in that very beginning part, like I used to hang out on top of that tanker. Like when you first walk into that room, I'd just scoot back and I would just hang out on that stuff and that tanker and just, or not tanker, was it a train? Yeah, it's like a train or a tram.
It's part of a train. It's like an oil tank.
Yeah. And so I'd hang out there, but now I've just been hanging out underneath that that basket that's up against the wall right on that side with the with that terminal. But it was a lot of fun, and it was pretty fast. Sharks, what did you think about this week's Nightfall?
Okay, so I haven't run this one yet, but I know that this is an easy Nightfall. Yes, out of all of them, without burn, it's going to be simple. This is a solo Nightfall. Now, the biggest thing is because this is a Nightfall that there are spots that you can sit in and protect yourself, and then if you have more people, even more so, because somebody can cover you and whatnot. Last week's a little bit different, but yes, I totally agree with you, Gray. Yes, this is a much easier Nightfall this week for sure.
Yeah, I mean, we went into it, and, you know, a lot of times for Nightfall, you got to have your wits about you. And for the team that I play with, a lot of the strikes is usually my wife, Hefty, and our buddy Legacy. We'll go in and we'll just run the strike playlist, and we're just screwing around. And we transitioned to do the Nightfall, and I felt like we could just screw around. Like, we weren't having to really focus on completing it. So if you're somebody listening and you don't normally do the Nightfall, this is the week to try it out, because this is the week that you can kind of get your feet wet and see what kind of almost a, it's kind of like a step between a true Nightfall and the strike playlist. It's kind of an in-between. I'm kind of curious to see what happens when they really crank this up and we're trying to get some really hard Nightfalls done in less than 30 minutes.
Oh, that's, you know what?
Get intense.
Omnigal with Arcburn.
You know what? Okay, so that was also part of the urgency behind my crybaby bitching about not getting Icebreaker, is I want to get it before shit hits the fan, because sometimes even in the strike playlist, when there's a burn modifier, it's like rough, you know, like you go in with two strangers. There's really only a very few times, probably I can count on one hand, how many times I've left someone behind in a strike. And probably over half of those have been since this new iteration of the strikes.
And one time was with Agrios and I.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. What did I go do, though? I remember that, but I don't remember where I went.
Since I'm not doing Saber Strike, this is the dumbest strike ever. I'm going to wait for them to have a glitch.
Oh.
Remember that, Agrios?
I mean, you guys didn't continue doing it, though, did you?
No, because there's only two of us, and we were under-leveled.
Well, then we all left. It was a thing, you know? Like, you guys just suffer.
There and did it one more round. We did it one more round, and we were like, we can't by ourselves. And you were like, I'm doing this. You guys should come and join me.
Right. I'm doing this. Destiny. but no, not only that, but this week, adding to what you were saying, Gray, is the primary booster. And so, you know, that helps a lot. There's a primary burn on it. So that's really excellent. But yeah, I still want to run these things. I don't know. Are we ready to move on? We've been talking about this forever. All right, let's move on. Unless Jez or Agrios wants to throw something in on this week's Nightfall.
Awesome. No, we need as much time as possible to talk about this week at Bungie.
Okay. Well, then
there's
I'll
nothing.
I wanted to say those two free tracks that Bungie had put up on the This Week at Bungie, last week's This Week at Bungie, those tracks are excellent. I think that I would buy an album of just Bungie putting out music. You know, like, I understand that they want to use their content for the game, and that's fine, but I just feel like everything they put out is so solid. It's just so awesome. It's like the Braveheart soundtrack every single time they put something out.
Wait a minute. They do have an album for their music.
They've done it twice.
No, but what I'm saying is I want more.
They've done three of them, but yeah, these latest tracks aren't on anything.
So, yeah.
Right. No, I want them to put out more music so I can just listen to it. Like, it's fantastic. You know, especially, like, I liked one of the tracks better than the other one because it just sounds so perfect to me. Those guys did such a great job. Let's see. Okay. Agrios, what do we got going on in the world of Bungie/Destiny?
Nothing.
Yeah?
Can I bring up a point before Agrios can get his thoughts together?
Right.
How ingenious was it for Bungie on, when you said the tracks, I thought you were talking about SRL. Bungie to put that stinking forklift in the middle of the track and make it a forklift instead of like a pillar or something else. The fact that it's actually a forklift actually gives so much character to that part of the track. I love the forklift. I love it. I mean, I hate it. I hate the forklift, but I love it.
You know, it's funny that you mentioned that because people have started to meme it like really badly on Twitter. And I fell for it once. The first time I ever went through that track, I fell for it. And then every other time, I have not hit it once again. And I feel really good about that because it is the bane of some people's existence in this community. Sharks, what do you think about the forklift?
It's pain in the ass because it's square and it stops you dead if you screw up. So you got to make sure. I mean, you hit it once, twice, three times, you know, you're just going to be pissed off. So yeah, and I've learned, I know where it is. Very, very rarely do I hit it now, but yeah, I sit there. It's actually, here's what's really bad about that forklift is because the dimensions that it has, you clip it, you stop dead or you blow up. Okay. It's one or the other. And so you can actually time it to knock people into it. And that, you know, you may be called a dirty player. I don't know. You may get messaged. I've been messaged a few times with things I've done in SRL, but yeah, it's gnarly.
Deej has said it is a Rumble playlist.
Yeah. Yep.
So I want to go further into SRL, but let's just get this forklift out of the way. Agrios, what do you think about that forklift?
I agree with Gray about the whole character thing. Like, I think they did a really good job giving it personality, making it a forklift. It's very clearly the year two pillar. Like, there's the pillar on the Mars track that's Mars track, right?
Yeah.
The pillar on the Mars track that's, you know, notorious for people spiking into it. And now, you know, the forklift is very clearly the year two version of that. And they just took last year's pillar and ran with it. Totally gave it character and everything. And I really dug that. So, yeah. Totally agree with Gray.
Jez?
I haven't actually been stopped by it too often. It seems to be more of a hindrance for other people. But I mean, it is fun when it does stop someone that's like ahead of you. But other than that, I think I always take that corner way too short. So I don't really have to deal with it. I'm usually going so slow that I don't really notice it.
That's a good one. Okay. So, SRL. I love, love, love SRL. I love doing something in Destiny that isn't shooting, although I do love shooting in Destiny. But I love this event. I love this. I love the whole feel about it. I love that part of the tower is decorated because of it. The whole thing is really cool. And racing, I don't know. I've never really been a racing guy. Like, I'm not always going and buying the best and fastest racing game, but I did spend a lot of time in Gran Turismo 2. A lot of time in Gran Turismo 2. So much time that I brought that over to Dreamcast, where it was running at even better refresh rate and everything was so smooth. but I am having a really, really hard time with how to control the situation. Like, some races I'm just so on top of everything and everything is going my way and the Sparrow is reacting exactly like I expect it to, and other times I just feel like there's like ghost bullets. I feel like there is a randomness to some, like I will come through that gate on Mars and I'll do my trick, and when I land, sometimes I just bounce straight off the ground, straight up, slow all the way down, and everyone goes by me. Other times, doing the same exact thing, I land perfectly, super smooth, just keep going. And I don't understand how to control the variables. On top of that, I'm really frustrated with the whole Rubin is racing aspect of this, because I feel like I'm never the person who's pushing other people around. I feel like I'm only the person pushed. And I want to know if you guys know of any, like, techniques that make me the pusher instead of the pushy. Even when my Sparrow comes up against somebody else, I'm the one who bounces off of them, and I don't understand this. Jez, I want to throw it to you first. Do you know of any techniques that make you the pusher, that make you solid and other people bounce off? Because I'm having a hard time here.
I'm not sure about so much about the solidness. I know... if I'm going around a corner and I'm behind someone, and I boost into the corner, I can overtake them pretty easily. And yes. If they hit you, it's going to slow them down instead of slow you down. I think it's whoever's ahead.
You think it's whoever's ahead is the person who becomes the solid sparrow?
Yeah. Like, I think it's harder to push someone until you're ahead of them.
You know, actually, now that you're saying that, I've found it both. I've found people behind me, they'll clip my end, and I will start pointing in another direction. So maybe that goes along with that. You're saying something about you being slow on the track. Maybe that has something to do with it. You know, something else I wanted to bring up was tricks not proccing in midair. Like, and you know what? I want to shout out real quickly to all the people who answered my tweet. I tweeted out, you know, that it's frustrating not being able to do tricks in the air. And I don't know what it is. Maybe I have idiot stamped on my forehead. And that's why in my profile picture, like, I'm kind of looking down to the side so people can't see it. But there were so many people who said to me, are you using a sparrow that has the destabilizer? And I just can't even fathom that. So I want to shout out to all those people who decided to go the route of, have you plugged it in? You know, that's basically what they're saying, you know, like, oh man, my computer doesn't work. And the person's saying to you, have you plugged it in? Because that's what it says to me. When I say I can't do tricks midair, and they say, are you using a sparrow that can do tricks? I mean, oh my God. So I want to thank all those people. Thank you for speaking up, you know, because I don't know, maybe I am an idiot. But I was definitely using the destabilized sparrows.
Anyone else think that they should have a trick sparrow that doesn't have the destabilizers and instead has a boost?
Oh, so like the boost, and then you can do the tricks on the D-pad instead of flipping? That would be really cool. You know what? Flipping has only ever caused me a heartache. I have a clip that I want to release, but it makes me look like an idiot, where I do a flip because I thought flips were cool, and my sparrow just kind of... like, I hit the ground and the front end pops up and I lost first place. And it was just the most frustrating thing ever. Agrios, do you have any tips or tricks on how to become the solid sparrow and not be the one that's pushed around?
Well, I have a bunch of tips and tricks for SRL in general. As far as that goes in particular, I don't know. I mean, as far as someone being ahead and having more stability because they're ahead, sounds plausible. I would most likely believe it has more to do with, you know, just the physics engine in the game. Like, it's going to take the direction you're moving and the force that you're providing in those directions, and depending on where the center of your mass is and where that object collides with you, I feel like the one that's moving the hardest in the direction it's trying to move into is going to cause the most movement, kind of type thing. So I feel like if he's trying to hit you, his nose is up there, and he's coming up past you, and he tinks into you hard, and you're just trying to drive straight ahead and not tink back into him, well, then you're going to move because he's providing more force directly into you.
I'll try that.
The way I've always felt is that the sparrow that's attempting to provide more force in that specific direction is going to not move away from that direction.
I will definitely. So if you're trying to drive straight ahead,
someone's trying to tink into you, well, then yeah, you're going to move, and they're not.
Interesting.
So my guess is they're peeking into you as they go past you.
Sharks, what do you got?
I want to hear Gray's first. I have an opinion on this, but I'm watching Gray go like this during Agrios' entire conversation. So Gray has his comment. Let Gray go, and then I'll tell you.
I have other SRL tips I'd like to share too, but let's hear what Gray has to say.
Yeah, I definitely want to hear your other tips, Agrios, but let's go to Gray. Gray, what is it that I'm doing wrong?
Nothing, actually. So I am a racing game aficionado. I play a lot of racing games. I have two racing chassis in my game room that are set up with Gran Turismo and different games that you can race against different people, racing wheels. The problem with SRL, the physics are completely off. Right, the physics just are they're arcade physics at best, and they're very poor arcade physics at that. That doesn't make it a bad game mode. It's still a ton of fun, but you can't expect things to react in the way that it would in a racing simulation type environment. I wish it did. I certainly would love if it did. But what I have found is the catch points on your Sparrow don't necessarily make sense. It's almost like there's a buffer area around your Sparrow, and you're never really quite sure what that area is, at which part of the Sparrow that's actually going to push another Sparrow out of the way or into another part of the track that you want them to move on to. The other thing that I notice is kind of what Jez said. The whole idea that the Sparrow in front actually has an advantage in terms of momentum and being able to push laterally, physically, from a physics standpoint, doesn't make sense. You should be able to actually adjust their momentum behind them and cause them who are in front of you to do something. And I feel like in the game, that's very difficult to do. Agrios, you're right in the sense that if you have more momentum, especially lateral momentum, pushing a Sparrow, they should move instead of you being affected by them. But the physics in the game just aren't really built very well for it. It's trying to put a racing mode into a game that isn't built to have racing physics. And they do an okay job, but you just can't expect it to respond in the way that you would expect it to.
Now, does that hold up when it comes to rear-wheel drive versus front-wheel drive?
So the whole idea would be that you're trying to actually break the traction points of the vehicle ahead of you. So it doesn't matter if it's rear or front. Rear might make it easier to break those traction points than it would be a front-wheel drive vehicle. But if you can break those traction points, then you should be able to get them to move a direction that they're not intending to go.
Okay, great. So I've noticed what you're talking about, and I meant to bring it up, but sometimes I'm just airheaded. I feel like what it is kind of like, you know, when you're in a car that's parked on the side of the road and there's cars zipping past your car kind of, moves. You can feel the suction and the push of it coming by you. And I feel like this is a factor in it. It feels like a wave almost. So I'm glad that you brought that up, because that's definitely something that I was thinking about. Like it's a weird buffer. You're really right about that.
Any tip or trick, the best way to be successful in Sparrow Racing League is just simply find the fastest way around the track, right? There's certain landing areas that tend to not lose speed because of whatever the physics are when you're hitting that area. You tend to retain your speed. There's certain pathways around these tracks that are significantly better. I was playing with Connor, we were doing Sparrow Racing League, and we were comparing some of our best lap times. He's had laps that are 30 seconds faster than me. And
holy crap.
I'm sitting there going, like, how do you shave? Again, I'm somebody who plays a lot of racing games. I'm happy if I can shave 2 seconds off of a lap time when I'm running a hot lap, let alone 30 seconds off of a lap time on a four and a half minute track. It blows my mind. But there are certain pathways around that are significantly faster than other pathways. Regardless of who's around you, if you can stay in the lane that's the fastest and maintain that around the track, you'll be successful.
You know, I the last time Sparrow Racing League came around, I described my evolution in racing as, you know, the first section of the racing was hitting all of the gates and keeping that boosted speed. And then there was another level where you take this alternate path where you miss gates, but you've actually come out in front of the other people. And it took me a lot longer to get to that point this time. And I'm just now hitting it. Just the last couple of days, I've been running those areas because they seem counterintuitive. As far as being ahead, I'm going to miss 2 speed gates, you know, in order to hit this shortcut. But every single time I skip that section, I come out in front of those people, even though.
Learn how to hit the gates.
What's that?
You should learn how to hit the gates and not take the shortcut. You will be faster if you hit the gates and don't take the shortcut.
Depends on the shortcut sometimes.
Nope. Always. The top racers hit every gate.
It also depends if you can make the corners well.
Not depends. It depends on whether you can take the long cut right. Because if you can take the long way through the gates right, you will be faster than the best person on the shortcut.
Okay, I'm not talking about those superhuman ones. I'm talking about every single time I take these shortcuts, I'm in front. What's that?
Don't skip gates. If you learn how to not skip the gate, you will come out ahead.
Okay, well then how come I'm in first place when I skip the gates?
World record holders don't skip gates.
I'm not a world record holder. I just want first place.
I'm just saying, though, that you, someone who learns how to take the path with the gates correctly will beat you.
That is true, but again, you recognize your own ability, your own limitations, and you say,
true.
You know, I can actually, if my goal is just to win the race, and my fastest way around the track is doing it in a certain specific way, I say, do it in that way, and you're going to win more often than somebody who's trying to do something that they're not actually going to be successful at for a very long time. Now, if dear Bungie wants to be one of those top elite players, I agree with you, Agrios. He needs to learn how to hit those gates. But I don't know that that's what he wants to be. He just wants to win more races than he loses.
You know, I hit gates, okay? I hit gates, okay? I'm a gate-hitting fool, okay? This is not.
You don't want to choose to skip any. Nobody's insinuating you can't hit gates.
You know what, though? You also said that the top players use those raid sparrows, yeah?
Yes.
So there's another layer to this SRL that I have yet to...
use raid sparrow. You don't have to use the raid sparrow to have top times.
To have the top times, yes, but not to have top times.
So
the guy that has the best records
in the world are all raid sparrows.
Overall, is not using those sparrows.
Okay, so I'm getting
all the best world records are the raid sparrows.
So one of you is wrong. One of you is wrong. Sharks is wrong, or Agrios is wrong.
No, wrong. He's listen. Saying that the top people are using other than the raid sparrows because they're finicky.
The guy that has all the records streams, and he does not use the raid sparrow.
But for his highest record, he did.
So who has the fastest in the world? Can we look this up?
They're not fun to use, so they're fast enough to beat almost everybody. Not
he who shall not be named.
They choose not to because they're more fun. I can't remember his name, but you can look it up on Destiny Tracker.
He just did an interview with Planet Destiny, a video interview. You can look it up on their site, too.
Yeah.
But the raid sparrows hold all the record time. The fastest sparrows, fastest trick sparrows in the game, the best trick sparrows in the game, stat-wise, are the Swift River SR1, which is the upgraded Red Bull quest, later unlocked for everybody, and the Referric Friend Infinite Vector Infinite, or something like that. Those two sparrows have equal stats, and they're slightly better than all the other trick sparrows.
Remy, we got to finish that, man.
Yeah. What? Yeah, you know, I just finished that last part, the Nightfall, with my son on the Xbox, and I just picked up that Vector Infinite. And you're right, like, it just has the slightest bit of boost more. I'm very excited about checking it out. Oh, but you know what I did get out of one of those packages was the, I forgot what it's called. Phantasmagoria or whatever. What was the name of the one that you're...
Prismatica,
is that it? That thing...
It's called the Prismatica right now.
It's so cool looking. Like, if you look at it...
When you gas it, it, like...
Yeah, there's just so many colors just come off the front of it. It's so cool. And now that I've got it on the Xbox, I will definitely be buying packages to try and get it on the PlayStation, because it is beautiful. It is beautiful. I mean, this will be after I get all of my other stuff. But I feel like I want to reward Bungie for doing a good job, and I want to spend money.
Do we know, are the Dawning packages like the old Sparrow packages, as in it won't give you duplicates?
That's a good question. I do not know.
If that's the case, I approve of that type of package.
Yeah, that's a good question. I don't know. I'll search some videos on YouTube that will show a bunch of people opening a bunch of packages and see if they get any.
That's why I approved of the packages for last year's Sparrow Racing event, was that you didn't get duplicates. If you bought more Sparrow Racing packages, you were guaranteed to get a Sparrow you didn't have. So
a lot of people have been doing it because they wanted the gear, and people were not getting duplicate gear, and the gear was dropping a lot higher than it was for Festival of the Lost.
I saw a lot of people getting duplicate gear in the videos that I've watched.
Well,
they were pissed.
The good gear? The good gear?
They might be getting duplicate
the other ones.
Yeah,
I'm not talking about
the consolation prize.
Yeah, I'm not talking about that one. I'm talking about
the consolation prize.
Bonding gear.
Okay.
So this may seem like easy knowledge for a lot of us, but maybe not for everybody. I talked to quite a few new rookies to the Sparrow Racing League this year that had no clue about any of this. But we alluded to it before, but you do gain boost from doing tricks. Now, a trick is as simple as hitting down on your D-pad while you're in the air. He'll do a little like handstand on his thing, and you'll get boost if you land from doing that. Really, really easy, simple to do. Don't try to do anything fancy. He'll send you flying anywhere. Just a quick little tap while you're in the air. More taps equals more boost. And the boost is vital for catching those missed gates without having to slow down and stuff like that. So that all becomes vital when you really get that path that Gray was talking about down pat.
I see what you're saying.
I think that's all my tips.
Got it. Got it, got it. Okay. Did you have anything else you want to talk about this SRL, Jez?
No. I think I said everything.
No, you're not asking me?
No, we're skipping sharks this time. Okay. You're a little prickly. No, I'm just joking. No, I from right to left, I see Jez, Agrios, Sharks, and then Gray.
Oh,
so you were next, Sharks.
I'd like to say real quick, T-Boys in the chat says that he opened $40 worth of packages and has not got a duplicate Sparrow yet.
Excellent. How many Sparrows did you get out of that $40? Inquiring minds want to know. He also says that shortcuts slow you down a lot. You know what it is? I'll tell you what it is, is that probably most times I'm not playing against people who have any idea what they're really doing. I'm not playing against champions. I'm playing against just regular average Joes like myself. And when those shortcuts work for me, those shortcuts work. Like I feel like my times are faster when I don't hit all those gates. I don't know.
The way that I decide if I'm going to take a shortcut or not, like, especially that one on Venus that's one giant ramp up and the other path has to take two sharp corners.
Yeah, that S.
I take that S if I have a lateral movement boost. Because I can zip. I can basically cut off the corners with that. But if I don't have that, I'll just take the big shortcut because it's just easier. I don't have to do anything, and people tend to get bunched up in that corner.
Right. I'm playing some normal people. T-Boy says, I got like 5 to 6 Sparrows, if I had to guess. I'm not in Destiny at the moment. Well, that's good.
I think that's almost all. I think there's maybe 8.
Right.
I'd have to look at a package to know.
Okay, Sharks, what did you want to add to SRL before we move on?
Okay, no, what I wanted to add is, you know, you were talking about having problems and everybody was talking about being able to control the Sparrows and bumping into stuff. Okay, first off, what we're doing, like what Gray was saying, this isn't a practical racer. First off, you're on a hoverboard, basically. You're floating, you're bouncing. You know, when you jump off of a cliff, that Sparrow doesn't just hit the ground, it bounces, okay? Now, so you have to take all that into consideration. When you're hitting something and you're racing against something and you're trying to knock people off, in a normal situation, you do police, you know, hits. You know, you do it in the corners and you knock them. Well, in a car, you keep going and hit. But on a Sparrow, you're going to hit and you're going to bounce back. It's like you're in space kind of thing. All right. So if you're going to actually want to hit somebody, you have to go up against them first. Then you get them in the corner. Then you move your Sparrow and do your side boost all at the same time. And that's how you're going to get people's Sparrows turning. All right. The other thing I wanted to say is, about the geometry of the game. We can't really see all the geometry in the game. This is just the thing when you do 3D animation. There are polygons there that are sticking out. They're up a little bit higher, and it's like an invisible wall, okay? So as racers, we just have to learn where these good spots are. For instance, on Venus map, there's a jump, and you go into a puddle. If you go into the puddle hard, you're going to stop. It slows it down every single time. So what you want to do is you want to fly over that puddle and go over it soft. And you're going to miss those angles. You may be doing the exact same trick, but your sparrow is going to different areas. It's going further. It's off to the side. You're just missing those polygons. There is actually on one of the new maps, and I'm drawing a blank on what the name of the map is, but it's the one that has multiple teleports. And on the very first teleport, it takes you into a U-turn before it splits off into the two top teleports. If you go into that teleport and you're using your helmet that puts you on the ground to move you faster, you will hit every single time and stop. So when you go through that teleport, you can't push down. You have to let it glide a little bit so that you miss that spot, and then you push down. So, you know, that it's just, again, it's knowing the maps. As far as, like, going faster, definitely want to hit all the boosts. But if you push down on your sparrow and you're hugging the ground, you go faster. The best racers, and I'm not a best racer, okay, I'm just going off what they say. They stay out of the air as much as possible. They do as few jumps as possible. Stick to the ground, hit the corners, use your side boost, and actually you can use your trick button, which you would think is your brake, but it's not really a brake. And you can cut corners really tight. I use that a lot because you'll cut the corner really tight. It won't slow you down. It just changes the angle of the speeder itself, the sparrow, and then you can go and you save those boosts. You know, there's all kinds of tricks to the trade, and it's just playing a lot to get it, and it can be very frustrating. You know, you think you're doing the same thing over and over and over again, and it's coming out different, but you're really not doing the same thing. You're doing minor details without realizing it. So.
You know, that's I remember last year Leopard Stealth was complaining, like, he did a lot of SRL. He was complaining, he was using the helmet, the racing helmet, and he would take that jump in Mars just before the fans, and sometimes the helmet would just push him right into the hole.
Oh, man. Yeah,
because you're too used to pushing forward.
Yeah. Sucks. I've done it. Because that's my go-to helmet now. You know, if I want to go out there and I just want to, like, try to kick butt, you use that because you're hugging the ground so much. But
your control helmet is key.
Yeah. Yeah, I've done it a lot, just like what you're saying with the Leopard Self did. You know, you're like, oh, shit, what am I doing? Pull up. Oh, it's too late, and I'm not going to make the jump, and boom, you're screwed.
There's actually a trick that you can do now, too. Now, I don't like to encourage glitching, but the fastest people are doing it now because they need to maintain times because they're all doing it, basically. If you use a raid sparrow, and so when you do the overdrive on the raid sparrow too long and force a blow-up, when it goes into the blow-up animation, you actually still ride it for quite a ways, and it goes much faster than at any other point. So they do things like, well, this isn't really a glitch yet. I'll mention the glitch in a second, but they'll do things like when they're approaching the finish line, they know the right point to hit the gas at the final finish line to blow it up crossing the finish line to get that extra boost going across there.
Interesting.
Even extra speed from doing that. But there's a glitch right now that they're doing. If you gas it on the Raid Sparrow, and you know the Venus map that has the or is the Mars map? No, it's the Venus map. There's a teleport right before the big fan blades. I get all the maps all mixed up.
Mars.
Mars.
Okay. So there's the teleport.
The main cannon, you mean?
Yeah, main cannon. Right before the big giant turbines, okay? If you gas it on the Raid Sparrow and blow it up just before entering the main cannon, it immediately respawns you right before the gate, right before the turbines. And it shaves about approximately one full second off of your lap time.
Interesting.
The other thing I wanted to say, and this is to your initial thing that you had tweeted out, I personally have noticed exactly what you're saying as far as emotes. And I haven't done enough testing with it, but I personally believe what it is we are doing the trick before the game realizes you're in the air. And so that's why it's doing the points. Because it won't do a trick when you're on the ground, all right? But you have to be a certain point up to get it. So if you hit that, it's going to point. And sometimes you don't have enough time, and I'll spam it and to try to hit it to get it out of that. But it's got to go through the whole point before it goes to that trick. So I'm guessing that's probably what the issue is. Wait a millisecond more before you start doing those tricks and see if it works. I'll have to try it myself and see if it works myself.
But I only really have anecdotal evidence because, of course, I'm not collecting evidence, but I've had that happen. And even after being free and clear for like a couple seconds in the jump and you press it again, it's still pointing. Really? I think if you get bumped in the air, you lose like the ability to trick.
Yeah,
if you're leaving a jump with someone next to you, I don't think it registers you as jumping. I think it registers you as being pushed into the air by a person.
I can see that. Yeah,
and that sucks. The whole time my guy's going like this.
Yeah, it's a waste.
Yeah, it's a bummer too.
Pulling the Remy trick. That's the Remy trick.
You know what's the worst part, and I've got a clip of this, and I want to post it. I'm pointing, and the guy that's making me not trick is doing a trick. Like, it's what? Right, check that guy out. I want to do that. I'm scared of heights.
That is awesome.
But yeah, for the most part, I'm really enjoying SRL. But I mean, I don't know how to counter the tilt, how to counter the rage that I feel when I'm leading absolutely the whole race, and then within the last two gates, I hit something or get bumped, and then I go right to the end of the pack. I don't think I got a single sixth place the last time SRL was here, and I've got like 3 sixth places, and I am just like, it just drives me batty.
That's what happened when I was playing Datto. Griffin and I are in the race. We're going through. I was literally in first place for 2 3/4 of the entire race. Datto was in fifth. And I was sitting there thinking, I'm going to take a screenshot of this and just send it to him. And I go, come on, Datto. And just, you know, laugh because I didn't even realize he had been in the match before. And he was like in second place or something. I just wanted to have a good Twitter shot, right? And literally, I was hitting all the gates, but whatever they were doing, they were hitting them better. And he comes up, him and two other people come up and pass me. And I didn't finish first. And I was like, you gotta be freaking kidding me, you know? So, yeah, it's frustrating. But you just gotta say, you know what? I had fun doing it.
Great. Remember, back of the pack, it's really big gates.
That's true. Yeah. That's true. Oftentimes, I'll have like 60 gates hit first place, and there will be like 65 gates hit last place.
Yeah.
So, great. You seem like a really. What's that?
I like to just hang out in third place until like the last half of the last lap, and then zip past everybody who's right in front of me. I'll just tail the people who are in second, first, and second, so I have big gates. Then I'll zip past them at the end.
You know, that's a good plan. I don't know how you decide that you're about to win. You know, like that's the problem I'm having.
I like it.
Gray, you seem like a really calm guy. And I feel like if, like, on your tombstone, it would say, like, try to always be positive. you know, like still in the afterlife, you will be calming people down. How do I do it? How do I fight this rage? Because I am pissed off when I'm first place the whole race and I'm like hitting these tiny gates and then something happens and I go right to even second or third. Like it just drives me up the wall. How do I stay calm? How do I just let it roll off my back?
So the biggest thing that I would recommend is it's nobody's fault except your own. Right? As you think about it like you're a racer, like you're a race car driver, right? You are only in control of your own lap times, your own decisions, your own way around that track. And if you lose, there's nobody else to blame but yourself. So what I would say, and this is, I mean, I get hard on myself. This Sparrow Racing League has been one of the hardest things for me because I consistently am in third to sixth place. And when I played Sparrow Racing League round one, I was double platinum. I rarely lost a race.
I know why. More hardcore players on PS4.
Well, I'm not even playing it that much on PS4. But what I think happened is that the matchmaking has actually become, I guess, dialed down or fixed for Sparrow Racing League. I don't know that last year there was good matchmaking for Sparrow Racing League. In fact, I think for a while when I'd go into DTR, it had it classified as like elimination or something. It had it almost as a different category. So they fixed that and they were able to get it cataloged. I think Bungie fixed the matchmaking and now there is matchmaking involved that's a little bit more skill based on the Sparrow Racing League. But I have noticed a big difference. My lap times are the same, right? Because I had the book from last year. I'm still running 429s, 430s, 431s, and I was winning races last year. Now I'm finishing third, fourth, second. You know, I've only won, I think I've raced 25 races and I've won 2 races out of those 25. As I look at it, I know that there's things that those drivers, those people on their Sparrows are doing to get around that track that are better than what I'm doing. And all I can do is learn from it and try to do better myself in terms of finding the right lanes, the right pathway to get around that track faster than somebody else. And then I play with somebody like Connor who can beat me by 30 seconds. I mean, 30 seconds is such a huge difference that I know that there's better ways around the track than what I'm currently doing.
See, Sharks is really good, okay? Sharks earn that, you know, that funky emblem that you only get if you're, like, one of Bungie's blessed children or whatever? Yeah, but Sharks has one of those. And he got it because he kicked the people who made the game's asses racing on a Sparrow, okay?
That is cool. And,
yeah, so... And I raced with him all last Sparrow Racing League and stuff. And I can keep up on Sharks' heels. So I guarantee that's where I what I know of Sparrow Racing, you know, down pat. And I feel like when I go into Sparrow Racing League, I only lose a match if I screwed it up. Like, I hit that forklift every freaking lap. And, you know, the second or third time I hit it, I'm like, ah. Oh, That did me, and I'm going to try hard, but there's no way I'm going to pull back ahead of first at this point. Sometimes I still do, but I definitely feel like I lose myself I lost it if I didn't take first.
And now?
No, that's how I feel now. That's how I feel. I feel like I'm the one who lost it if I don't take first.
You know, I feel like I must have missed what you were saying, Gray, because... You know, the idea that I have no one to blame but myself, that just kind of pisses me off more. So maybe you could rephrase it so I can understand what you're trying to say, because
he wants you to have a pissed off epiphany. Like, he wants you to get so pissed off that you like pop and go zen.
That's what I'm saying. Like, this is some kind of like Tony Robbins. Okay.
So you can do a few things here, right? You can blame your equipment, right? And you can say that people have these stupid raid Sparrows and they're able to beat me because they have better equipment. And certainly there's a few people out there, but I don't have the raid Sparrow. Most people don't have those raid Sparrows. I don't seem to be losing to those raid Sparrows consistently. So I don't know that it's equipment that we can necessarily blame. I think it comes down to there's obviously a higher skilled player base that I'm playing against compared to last year. last year my 4:30 times were plenty good to win races, and that's not the case this year. So I just have to look at myself and say, I got to figure out how to get 4:27s, 4:26s. That's the only way that I'm going to win. And obviously other people have figured it out, and I think I'm a pretty good racer. I got to figure this out too. I got to make sure that I, and it doesn't make me mad when I lose. It just makes me think like there's something to this that I still have yet to learn, something that I can improve on. And in a game like Destiny that many of us have played 800 to 2000 hours in, there's probably not too many things that we can easily pinpoint and say, this is something in the game that I know I can improve on. And this is one thing that I think that we can.
Yeah, I think I can improve on everything in Destiny yet. I suck.
You know, I'll have to try and think about this next time I'm racing. And you know what? I wanted to bring up again before we go. Sharks was saying that once he got the icebreaker, that was really his go-to gun. And then Agrios was saying that Bungie has done a good job making other exotics worthwhile. And I really feel like this is true. And I'm curious to know how long it takes each of our evolutions to go from where we are now to something new. Because for me, I started off with auto rifles. I always felt really, really, really good with auto rifles. You know, I played a little bit with hand cannons, didn't really get the feel for them. I played a little bit with pulse rifles, didn't really get the feel for them. Found scout rifles, and then just kind of went from there. Like once scout rifles were on the plate, I felt like that, like I was comfortable there, and so with exotics and how they, you know, you can only use one at a time. I feel like I talked about this last week, how really I go to the Trespasser at this point, PvP and PvE, especially though I don't want to use anything other than Trespasser in PvP. I haven't been mad at a single shotgunner since I picked up that Trespasser. And it's because they're all suckers for it. They all want to slide shotgun me, and they're dead before the slide is over. And it's such a great feeling to be able to shut down somebody who wants to, you know, really not play the game. They don't want to play Destiny. They want to just win. And I stop them from winning. And I know that they're pissed off. And I know that at some point...
Wait. Okay, Remy's excited because he found a way to win against the people who are only happy about winning.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, because otherwise, because the other option is I'm a latrine, and you know what happens to a latrine. So
that's the same way they feel. That's why they're using that shotgun.
No, but that's just it. That's just it. It still takes ability. You know, it's not a one hit kill. You have to put. No, shotguns are for the most part one hit kills. That's what's
One hit kill from a certain range that people with Trespassers can apparently easily take you down from. So it takes a certain amount of skill.
It does take a certain amount of skill.
For the Trespasser.
To use the Trespasser. It takes a certain amount of skill to use the Trespasser.
Well, it takes a certain amount of skill for to be a shotgunner and get past the Trespasser, then, according to what you're saying.
That's right. And they haven't figured out how to do it yet because they're so concerned with just winning. They don't want to get better. That's what I'm trying to say. What's that, Agrios?
I said I'll get you. One-on-one. Crucible.
Let's do it.
Trespasser. You trespass early, me shotgun only.
You will die. You will die horribly over and over and over.
Shotgun only, Crucible.
You know what? This should be... You know what we should do? We should make a TV Guide channel deal. Like, you know, on the 27th for our 3-year anniversary, like this hour will be like, you know, Sparrow Racing. And this hour will be like Lawn Boy said we should do like an Inferno Trials tournament, and then like 4 o'clock it'll be like Showdown Agrios Shotgun versus Remy Trespasser, and we'll see once and for all, you know. Maybe we'll make a tournament out of that. We'll line up all the people who want to use a shotgun, and I will mow you all down, all of you. And I'm not someone who brags. I do not brag easily because bragging is a horrible, horrible, ugly thing. But the trespasser's magic. anyways. Was there anything else that we should talk about?
Cosmo put bring back the Mythoclast onto the list of stuff that Bungie needs to get done, according to the community.
Oh, yeah, this is something that's going around, Agrios?
No, this is what Cosmo added to the Bungie's recognized list of community desires.
Oh, very cool. We need to take a closer look at that for the podcast, because that would make good radio. But yeah, I don't know.
We'll probably need filler in the next couple of weeks, so that won't be a problem.
I like it. I like it a lot.
I think they should bring it back when they, as a reward for updated hard mode, Vault of Glass and Crota raids. It should be the carrot for updating the difficulty on prior historical raids.
Come on, just raid scoring. There we go.
So do you think that they would taken it, or that they would SIVA it, or something else?
My hope would be neither, actually. I mean, coming from somebody who didn't play year one, I'd rather have those be difficult experiences for what they are in themselves. I don't necessarily want everything to be SIVA'd.
Come on, guys. We're in year three. Why not both? Or all three, rather.
Ooh. Are you saying random, like when you join in random, or that you can choose?
Ornaments. Ornaments, guys.
Ornaments?
Yeah, just put an ornament on it. Here's a SIVA one. Here's a taken one.
Oh, I'm talking about the raid itself, Jez.
Oh, no. That'd be random. Yeah. They could add some randomness to that.
I don't know.
I think there'd be a lot of people disappointed that there wasn't an update. Like, I think there's a lot of Guardians who'd be like, you know, I ran Vault of Glass 567 times when it was on level for me. I don't want to run it another 567 times, the exact same thing on level for me again with just my current loadout. So I could see them having at least half of the community having problems with there not being some sort of change to the update.
Do you remember when the community just thought that Vault of Glass was going to get an update? And I think Luke Smith tweeted out that they didn't have any plans at all to update it.
Well, I mean, originally people thought that, you know, the endgame content was always going to be endgame content. And, like, when we got Dark Below, we were also going to, you know, get very hard level Vault of Glass. And that it just didn't happen. But you know what? I mean, a game like Destiny was unprecedented on console. Console players, people who are particularly exclusively console players, had no sort of, you know, preconceived notion for what Destiny was going to be. They had, you know, no example about how that update was going to work.
I see what you're saying.
I have two different things once we're moving on. Just let me know and I should go into them.
Do it.
Okay. I saw something on Reddit this week, and I thought it was neat. It made me think, you know, how to evolve it another step further that I thought would be neat, especially, you know, Destiny 2 should be, you know, be on next gen, should have better and more options as far as its capabilities go and things. But wouldn't it be cool if when you loaded into the tower, your two guardians that you're not currently using also loaded into the tower, just like hanging out somewhere doing something? Like your hunter's just down in the lounge, like flipping his knife in the corner, and your titan's over sitting chatting with the new monarchy guy. And yeah, all those random people moving around the tower are other people's guardians that they're not currently using, milling about the tower doing things.
That would make for a lot of guardians in the tower.
Well, just think about how many random useless individuals are walking around now. Just remove them all and have them replaced. Like, if you're the only one in the tower, yeah, there's just these random bots walking around. But as new guardians load in, those bots change into their titan instead of random dude A or random dude B. You know what I mean? So that the population of the tower is then converted into other people's guardians. And then wouldn't it be neat, too, if I'm on my warlock and I want to mess with my titan and his loadout, I could walk over to my titan in the tower and like push a button and like trade into that Titan, and my Warlock would start doing something in the tower, and my Titan would then be me. I could run around, go to his vault, do his loadout, mess with his bounties. You know, maybe a little ghost loading icon or something for a moment when you can't do anything while you're switching characters. But instead of having to, you know, go back to orbit, load back into the tower, stuff like that, I just think it would add a lot more atmosphere, and you could see other people's versions, other people's guardians. It would give other people more of a way to show off their characters and, you know, their originality and such.
Interesting. Cultrosity.
You'll see a lot more, not transmog, but vanity sets of gear.
Right.
If that were the case.
Which I think is a great thing.
Cultrosity says this would be a sweet idea. What's that, Agrios?
Oh, what Jen says, yeah. It would give a lot more reason, and I mean, screw us on vault space and everything, but, like, there's a blue set you really, really like. It gives you all that much more reason to dress your Titan or your Hunter that you're not on right now up in that set of blue armor that looks real cool, because he's going to be milling about in the tower every time you're in the tower showing off that set.
It would be nice to be able to grab stuff off of your alts without having to switch characters or use an app.
Right, or even be able to just check their inventory. You know, there it is standing there, and you just be able to walk up. You know, I had to whittle down my answering cords down to one, because I ended up not liking one, and I was like, well, where is it even? It's not on this character. It's not in my vault. And then even when I went to go check for it on my other character, I didn't see it, and I started to stress out. it was there for some reason. I don't know. But this is a very interesting idea. There are a lot of just regular people wandering around the tower. Although I would have to say that it would be weird seeing like a guardian that was not being controlled by a character, you know, like they're sitting, like you're saying, they're sitting down in that hunter bar. That would actually lead to, I think, a slightly more immersive world, just based on the fact that, like, I don't know, when guys sit down in chairs, that's not how you sit down in a chair. Like, they would be able to control your character in the same manner they're controlling these other things, like maybe walking around with, like, those tablets. You know, that would be pretty cool. Weird, though. I'll have to think on this.
You know
how
useless a lot of the random characters in the tower are right now.
Totally.
I mean, no one with any personality or sweeper bot or the people you get quests from.
Right.
There are, like, those other ones are just totally useless. Like, this would just
sweeper
totally
bot is very hardworking, Agrios. They take offense to that.
No, I said that the rest were useless except for people like sweeper bot who has characters.
Imagine you're just following your guardian around to see what he's doing, and it goes over to sweeper bot, swipes his broom, and starts sweeping.
That would be really cool. There was a very small scene before the game released where, like, it looked like somebody was walking this, like, patrol. That would be really cool, watching your other guardians on some kind of patrol, or even sweeping. Maybe you could even select it, you know, like when I'm not controlling this character is sweeping, or, you know, this character is hanging out with Cade or something like this.
Here we go with our pipe dreams again, but, like, okay, you know, high hopes for next-gen systems and whatnot, but, I mean, I was just thinking about, what do you do in the tower when you're bored or not doing anything important? You harassed other people on your fire team and stuff like that. So wouldn't it be funny if, like, while you're hanging out in the tower and stuff like that, like, your Titan just jogs over and, like, gives somebody else in your, like, squad bunny ears or something like that, and then jogs away? Like, I don't know.
That would be pretty cool.
As you're saying that, I'm, like, thinking, every time I'm in the tower and I'm waiting for someone, I'm just running around in circles.
Yeah, you know what I do? I try and go from one end of those four pillars in the very front. I try and jump onto each of them and make it all the way across. I've never made it all the way across, but I've made it all the way from the first three from both sides.
But
so,
I mean, like, how awesome would that be if you were just, like, standing there in the tower talking to one of your friends, waiting for your other friend at the vault, and, like, your hunter just comes up and jogs by and does a little loop around you guys and jogs off into the other wing or whatever. Like, that'd be freaking awesome.
I agree. okay. What else we got, Agrios? We're running out of time.
Well, I don't have a whole lot. You guys went over the, I didn't get a chance to catch our podcast from last week. So did you, you guys went over the weekly update and everything?
I mean, I did some really half-assed job. I read some of the important updates, and then we just kind of covered everything. Like, I don't think that we missed anything.
Okay, so. Well, that's cool beans. I don't have a lot new this week. We pretty much touched on everything that I've had through our discussions here. One thing that I think I'd like to bring up, this is via our friend of the a podcast here, SDF River, also known to our current viewers as Hollow River. He heard on from Dustin Legere that he thinks that Destiny 2 is going to opt to drop the PlayStation exclusives in favor of Xbox exclusives again. What do you guys think about if, what do you think the odds are that they're going to do this? And how do you think the community is going to react, I guess? Let's go to you first, Remy.
Okay. I'm really glad you brought this up. I can't believe I forgot it. Again, sometimes an airhead. This is a very interesting thing. I remember when they announced that PlayStation was going to get exclusives, and every Xbox fanboy just basically lost their shit. You know, like, they felt betrayed because, you know, they were the ones who had lined Bungie's pockets with their previous games. You know, Bungie didn't have games on the PlayStation. So they felt like they were leaving them behind. And I don't necessarily disagree with that, but I feel like this is a case of... What's that?
I said, it's not like Bungie had a choice. They were owned by Xbox.
No, but that's what I'm saying. But I mean, it still was people who, you know, if their games didn't sell, it wouldn't be on PlayStation fans that Halo didn't do good, you know? So I can kind of see where they're coming from there. But I feel like Bungie has made it very clear that they've moved past, you know, playing favorites with Microsoft. You know, like, everything that they've done so far has been PlayStation first. You know, like, even with Twitch streams and, you know, bounties, they're always going straight to the PlayStation. And so I just can't imagine them. I just can't imagine any reason why Destiny 2 would feature Xbox exclusive anythings unless it happened to be different. So PlayStation gets these exclusives, Xbox gets these exclusives. This is the only way I can imagine it rolling out. Like, I feel like there had to be some bad blood between Microsoft and Xbox. Microsoft and Bungie. You know, even if it was just, you know, you were our employer previously, and now you're not, and we're going to go move in this other direction.
See, I don't think it has anything to do with bad blood or not. I think it was simply PlayStation made them the better offer.
And so you're thinking that Xbox might have made them the better offer for PlayStation? Or for Destiny 2?
Well, no, I'm not saying... I don't think it'll switch, okay? I think Xbox would have to make them such a better offer, like, such a better offer to get them to switch over at this point, because they would send the fan base into an uproar. Not only did, you know, they push these PlayStation exclusives the whole way through, but they totally embraced the PlayStation to the point where they were part of a PlayStation bundle. And as you can see, Sharks is holding up there. They helped design the DS4 controller with PlayStation for Destiny. So the bundle is the real thing for me. Like, you release a game with a bundle like that while you have exclusives on that system and encourage players to be like, this is our system, go buy our Destiny system. Then the next game, you're like, okay, no exclusives for you anymore. You went out and bought that exclusive system re-released, you know? Like, that elevates it to, like, an extra slap on the face to switch over. So that's why I say I think at this point they would have to, Xbox would have to offer such a hugely better deal to get them to do that, that it just probably wouldn't happen. I hope they don't do any exclusives at all.
So, here. Sharks? Oh.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, you're not next, Gray. Sharks?
Yeah?
What do you think?
There's no way. Not a chance. No way.
Nope. There's too much invested between PlayStation, Activision, and Bungie for them to drop any of this and it go to another company like Xbox. Especially when we already know that majority of the Destiny community is on PlayStation. You know, Bungie always says, "Oh, you know, we are doing everything for the Xbox community," but at the same time, we know for a fact that it's just not as big. So there's no way that Bungie would say, oh, "Okay, well, we're gonna give you guys exclusives, the little guys," and to top it all off, it wouldn't surprise me if there is already something written down somewhere that they're going to have it exclusive for, you know, the next who knows how many years, you know, Destiny 2 or whatever. And then this goes back into we don't really know what Destiny 2 is going to be. You know, so, I mean, if it's a complete new game, you know, that might throw things into the equation, but if it's quote unquote add-ons to the game, you know, we have no idea. But no, I can't see any exclusives going to Xbox. I could see them not having exclusives for PlayStation, you know, get rid of exclusives, but then at the same time, Activision loves doing that. I mean, they've been doing that for, you know, as long as I can remember. You know, with other, not necessarily with PlayStation, but I mean, when they get into this thing, oh, you know, like playing Call of Duty, the Xbox community always got the stuff before the PlayStation community because they made that big, huge deal with them. That was a way to promote it. And that's why Call of Duty was so much bigger on Xbox. But now that Activision and Bungie have really pushed this on PlayStation, no, I can't see them taking any of that away and giving it to another company. And the other thing is, like, look at all the stuff. Every time we ever see any promotion, it's usually through PlayStation anyways, or Bungie themselves. So, you know, how often have you seen an ad run through Xbox? You know, they're like, oh, look at Destiny. Yeah, maybe a clip, but nothing really. I can't see it changing, personally.
Gray?
So, real quick, I'd like to hear a response from Gray on this question, too. So it's basically free money on the table that they'd be turning down to not offer an exclusive to somebody if these offers are on the table. Would you rather they took the money from the PlayStation offer and made Destiny a better game using that money, some of that money at least? Or would you rather they made, not what you think they're going to do, or would you rather they made Destiny exclusive free? Would you rather have a better game with the money they get from the exclusives or have an exclusive free game? Greg, you want to go ahead and share?
So I would first say that it isn't free money. There is an opportunity cost here that they have to weigh. What they are essentially saying is that whichever console manufacturer is willing to pay has to exceed the amount at which they are going to lose revenue on the opposing competitive console. There's a cost there by accepting that exclusivity contract that some people on the Xbox might say, I'm not gonna buy two consoles, I'm not gonna buy a PS4, and so screw your game because of your exclusive deal with Sony. And that's a cost that they have to weigh. Now, with that said, I also don't think this is a Bungie decision. I think this is an Activision decision. I think that these are made at the publisher level. And if you look at Activision, you guys would have to correct me, but a little bit of quick research, I don't know that they have any exclusive deals going on right now with Microsoft since they moved Call of Duty over in 2015. So
I believe you're correct. But also in the case of Destiny, which is unique to the case of Destiny compared to other games, and this was part of their lesson learned from their dealings with Microsoft, is they retained almost equal rights in making these decisions with Activision.
Mm-hmm.
So they both have to agree, you know, it doesn't happen type thing.
Right. Yeah, so I mean, they've got some external pressure, but they've got a little bit more power than what another developer might have. I think that Activision's going to maintain this relationship with Sony as long as that business relationship is positive, is strong, is profitable, and is more profitable than the opportunity cost of the negative impact on the opposing player base. As soon as that switches, though, if things go sour between Sony and Activision, I think it's an easy switch to jump over to Microsoft or get rid of the exclusive contracts altogether. The only thing which might, and I think that we haven't brought this up yet, I think what Dustin was bringing up was more the fact that Xbox might actually be able to bring something to the table that PlayStation can't with the Scorpio. If the Scorpio can actually launch at the time at which Destiny 2 is ready to launch, and there can actually be an experience because of the hardware of that console that cannot be replicated on the PlayStation side, there might be some market reasons why Bungie would want to go that direction in order to bring the best game, especially not even just the best game on the market today. Hey,
Oh, somebody warned the chat. There goes Gray again.
Okay, so as Gray's fixing this audio, I just...
Hopefully River can cut that out.
Oh, yeah. No, okay. I'll let you continue before I say anything then. Go on.
All right. I think that my mic is back to normal. Are we good?
Hold on. Before you go... Before you go, Gray, we got the scoop. Lay's Summerstone says Destiny 2 will be a match 3 game for iPhone. So I don't have an iPhone, so I might be screwed.
Yeah, but they might have this parity between Windows phones, Xbox, and Windows 10 that you can play this match 3 game on all 3 consoles.
Oh. I don't know. I don't know. I trust Lays.
I don't really play Destiny on my mobile and on PlayStation.
All right, run out of time. Gray, what were your thoughts before you got cut off?
You're muted now.
I mean, I personally think that it won't work so well, mostly because the market share is currently in PlayStation, so they sell more statistically to PlayStation, and the numbers usually back that up. But it's not really. I think they'd do away with the exclusive altogether. They would go to Xbox.
The one thing I wanted to say on what Gray was saying about, you know, Scorpio maybe coming in and being able to pull Bungie and Activision over to them to add any exclusives, the only issue I see with that is both Microsoft and PlayStation have said that when these new systems are on the market, that they will not make games exclusive for that. Everything will be going on the old system still, because they don't want these systems being the next gen. So
that doesn't mean it's not going to be better on the next gen or on the next gen.
It'll look better and possibly run smoother, but it's not going to allow you to add more things to it.
Right. So they're not, and they said, you know, basically they want, you know, they want the games to be in parity, you know, and so because of that, there would be no reason for Bungie and Activision to jump ship over to another console to give something, when both companies have said that we want these games to be right aligned with each other. So you'll be able to hit a switch and make it look a little bit better, but there's not going to be enough to cause them to say, okay, well, we're going to have an exclusive here.
But wait a minute here. Gray brought up a good point about the whole, like, okay, does Activision have any deals with Xbox right now? What if there's something massive in the works that we're not aware of? And what if all of COD and everything on the next iteration and all that stuff is all going to flip up to Xbox again? and Destiny's just caught up in that whole deal.
But the thing that we're not looking at is these companies like Activision that do these deals. They do these deals because they know that they're going to get better promotion because that particular console is doing better. Like, for instance, with all the deals that Microsoft had on Xbox on the 360, that was because PlayStation was not the top tier game system. It was Xbox. Xbox had a lot more people pushing on them.
That's because they had such low sales to begin with. PlayStation got all of the sales. Let's say that there's 60 million gamers. You know, many, 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 many of them more went to PlayStation first. Now, this year, they still want to play video games. Now they're buying those Xboxes. That's what I'm seeing. I'm seeing Xbox catching up. You can't sell another PlayStation to somebody who has a PlayStation already unless you offer them new stuff to them. So the Xbox One S is what brought that back up. People are like, okay, I didn't want to buy that Xbox One.
But if you look at the numbers that both companies are putting out, both of them are saying, you know, they're having great sales, but every single month PlayStation is still selling more overall than Xbox. So, you know, they may be quote unquote catching up, but they're still being outsold. So there's going to be a bigger market for, in this case, at this particular moment, for PlayStation. So Activision as a big company would say, well, it'd be stupid for us to not put it into the bigger company that's going to get it to more customers. That's what I'm saying. Whether it's true or not, I mean, we don't really know all the numbers, but I mean, just by what they announce, it seems to me at this point in time that Microsoft hasn't caught up and surpassed. So these companies wouldn't send the exclusives over to the smaller company.
But so this is the only linchpin, I think, in the whole deal. And this is the unknown. It's what we don't know yet. What I know is that the PS4 has been a little bit of a disappointment in the sense that the content hasn't been there for me to sit there. And I have a PS4 Pro to go, wow, this is different. This is special. This is unique. This is a step above what's currently out there on the market. Now, what I don't know is that next year, next holiday season, when Scorpio launches, and Activision probably has a more decent idea since they have the developer consoles in-house. They can see what they can program on. They might be in a place.
Lay's just brought up the best point I've heard yet. He says, but is Xbox plus PC bigger than PlayStation? And that's it right there. If Destiny 2 is in fact coming to PC, Microsoft has a corner on that. Like that right there is all I needed to hear to believe that it could be Xbox getting exclusives. Like that's the best point there is. You were right with what you said, Gray. Sharks, you had great points. Agrios, Jez, all great points. But yeah, Xbox plus PC, like we're talking huge, huge numbers there. We're talking huge audience. That's it. That's the end of the conversation right there.
Wait a minute, though. It wouldn't be Microsoft exclusive then. If
it's anything, iOS. It's going to be Apple exclusive.
Yeah, it would be PC. Yeah, not Apple, but yeah, I mean, it would be the PC manufacturers because the PC sales are going to be way more than...
You could make it Xbox/Windows exclusive.
That's what I'm saying. That's exactly what I'm saying. Like... I don't know. I see that. I see that way going. Lays, that was such a great point. You kicking ass there in the chat. And you know what? You needed to buy your Christmas presents. It's okay. You know, the first hour and 40 minutes of this show was just me complaining about SRL and where's my vault space. And I still haven't got Icebreaker, you know? So you skipped all the stupid...
Even if it was just Xbox exclusive, they could offer them still perks on the PC side in exchange for making it Xbox exclusive.
All right. We are out of time. Anything else you want to say, Jez?
Dude.
Agrio is drinking. Sharks, anything else you want to add?
Nope.
Gray?
I'm hoping that the Scorpio is a totally different experience than what the PS4 Pro has been. I hope that it's like we're playing a different generation of gaming console. And if that is the case, that would be what brings Destiny to the Microsoft side.
Man, it's all crazy to think about. And I agree. I hope you're right. I hope it is like playing a whole nother generation. I forgot what the term for it is, but how technology is getting faster and smaller, and cheaper.
Pro coming out next year.
Yeah, that's true. Agrios, is there anything else you wanted to bring up before we go?
No, good job on the strikes, though. Like, less like crappy people on strikes.
All right, shout outs, starting with you, Gray.
So my shout out this week goes to our newest Guardian 1 member, Connor. I am so happy that he chose to join our ranks. He fits a very unique spot in the Guardian 1 clan in that he's heavy PvP and very good at it as well. Very interested in helping people become better at PvP. And his Christmas gift to me is hopefully going to be a flawless trials card going on this weekend. The other reason why I want to thank him is I got to do something with him and Punisher, another one of our Guardian 1 members, a couple weeks ago. 2 weeks ago, we ran a trials card that we got 8 wins, went 4v4 in the last win on our card, and we lost. And then that was our mercy. And then we lost the next round to God Squad, which is a very good PvP clan that just 5-0'd us on our last, you know, try of going flawless. And I wasn't even that sad, because you hear people say like, oh, I went 8 wins and then I had 4 round wins and then I lost it all. And you're always kind of like, oh, you know, bullshit, whatever, you got that close, no way. We seriously got that close, and then we ended up losing. And I was okay with it, because it just felt good to have that good of a card, you know, under my belt for the weekend. So hopefully tomorrow we're going to stream a little, and we're going to do, when Trials launches, Punisher and Connor and I, we're going to do a Lighthouse run. So hopefully you guys can watch.
Excellent. Sharks.
My shout-out is to Bungie's Chris Barrett. He's badass in so many different ways. He designed all these pixel shirts, and the reason that I'm shouting out to him is because he's doing his Orcs Design Labs, making stuff like this for people that are making video games in his own free time, giving it to people for free. So he's badass.
That's awesome. Very awesome. Agrios.
Merry Christmas to all, and to G1, a good night.
I like it. Jez.
My shout out goes to the chat, because they're the heroes of the show.
They are the heroes of the show, aren't they? I agree. I like it. My shout out, I have 2 shout outs. Number 1 to my son, who will be 2 years old tomorrow. I love you very much, and you are a very interesting little person. And then the other shout out is to my daughter, who just the other day beat the first level in Destiny all by herself, and made it to the tower. And we got to go to her postmaster, and she's been playing Destiny for a long time, but she hasn't been all up here yet, where she is able to make it through the level. You know, that first level, it starts off really slowly, you know, walk to an area, and then it pick up a gun, and then kill a couple of bad guys, and then, you know, maneuver through these trip mines. And then there's the part where they send up that flare. Like, the whole thing just gets harder and harder. And she did it. She made it all the way through. She's actually made it through that first level twice now. And it was so much fun. I was talking to Flounder about going, just finishing the level for her, so that I could go into the postmaster and pull everything out that she must have accumulated. But, you know, she talked me down and said she just has to do it on her own. And I definitely agree. I definitely wanted her to do it on her own, because, you know, that it says a lot about her as a gamer, being able to complete that first mission. I mean, it's simple to everyone who plays video games all the time, but to me and to her, you know, this is a huge milestone. And so congratulations. I'm very, really very happy for you, and you did a great job. She really just punched everything all the way through. But she did it. so, right? She is a Titan. She made it through the first time on her Titan, and then the second time, I think she did it on her Warlock. So, it's really fun watching her play. So, that's my shout-outs. And that wraps up episode 113. We would like to thank everyone listening for tuning in. We hope you enjoyed the show. If you have any suggestions for topics to be discussed on the show or have any comments on something that has already been covered, please leave them in the comments below or send them to feedback@guardian1.net. And we will see you next week.
Ho, ho, ho.